A voice in the desert was heard, prepare the way of the Lord. May every mountain make low, every valley be filled. These are the words that was registered in the Gospel of Luke, and they are the words of John the Baptist. If you recall in the first reading today, we have the prophet Baruch. Remember, there are four prophets that comes in this time when the chosen people of God, not first, not but the second exile of Babylon. And we know that the people were very, as we say, demoralized, because they have heard from their fathers and mothers what Nebuchadnezzar did when he took them out of the land of Judah. We know that he burned their temple, destroy their homes. And we know that he took them all enslavement for 70 years. And during that time of enslavement in exile in Babylon, they cannot teach their language, they have no place for worship, and they were really lost. And we know that the people have lost heart. At this time, God is sending four prophets to really build up the morale of the people. And we know that they were Habakkuk, Haggai, and Ezekiel. And we know that these people went and told the people that although everything is devastated, and yes, it's true, what your parents are telling you is true, but it's not you, but God is going to do what he ever did. The promise he made to Abraham and all who comes after him is going to continue. And this promise is that he will be your God, and you are supposed to be his people. But because of your stubbornness, you throw yourself after other gods. But God will continue to hold his promise. And look now, he is going to make your land again flourish. The waters and everything that's going to be with it is going to really refresh and bring vegetation, and bring orchards, and bring so much beauty to the land of Judah. And yes, he is coming. He is coming to take you from the north and the west, from the north and the south, from the east and the west. He is going to take you home. That was his promise, and that's what he will do. That was the hope of the chosen people. Now we know that that time has come. After many thousands of years, God raised a man named John, son of Zechariah, to be the last prophet. In fact, this prophet was the one who pointed Jesus to the world. Etche on his name. Behold the Lamb of God. Behold him who takes away the sin of the world. And that John is preparing a people prior to the coming of Jesus, so that they will be worthy of his coming. And what he said today, prepare the way of the Lord. Make ready the ways. Every mountain shall be put low. Every valley shall be filled. So that the land will be smooth. So the Lord, when he comes, he finds you ready. And what is that he is going to make us ready for? And that is what St. Paul said in the second reading today in the Philippians. St. Paul had great words for the people of Philippi. And he said to them, from the day I arrived at your country, you wanted me. From the day you hear my message, you embrace it. From the day that you become aware that I have come to you with a message that was not mine, but the divine one that I brought from the Lord Jesus who revealed it to me, you embrace it. And because of this, you are living a life very worthy of your calling. And St. Paul said, I know that what started in you, God will bring it to completion. I know that what is good in you, God will bring it to the focus of its completion. And then he continued to say, be prepared, because the day of the Lord is coming, so that you can stand front of the world, so that you will be ready to be embraced by him and dwell here in his kingdom. Now, my dear people, the readings are beautiful, and we know that scripture is inspiring, but what are the mountains and the valley that the prophet is speaking? Well, first of all, the mountains are those obstacles that take us away from that relationship with God. And that relationship with God really hinder our relationship with one another. Many times, you know, we say, what are those relationships that is hinder me from God? The lack of love. When I fail to love, when I do not love as he asks me to do, that is a hindrance. And what is that caused this hindrance? The grudges that sometimes we have for other people. Sometimes you enter in a room and the body language is enough to kill you. They stop talking, they don't want to say hello to you. It's like, you know, you killed their mother. The attitude every one of you experiences. I did, I don't know about you, but I think all of us did. That attitude that sometimes really we play the role of uncivilized people, but even civilized people, at least out of etiquette, you do say hello. You open your arms and welcome some people. What are the mountains that the prophet is speaking? It's the mountain of jealousy that sometimes we have. Jealousy against my neighbor. My neighbor has a car or two cars. They have this, they have this. And then you begin to say, where they get all this? Are they in the mafia? Are they in drugs? Are they in this? All kinds of things that you say. What jealousy is going to earn you? Nothing. In fact, the other person does not even know that you are jealous about them. And then we have that grudges of the neighbor. Father, you don't understand. My son was young when he went into their yard running for a ball, and they think he had some bushes or plants he has, and he called the police on us. Why he has to do that? Well, that's something that happened 4 years ago. For love of God, we have a bad day, let go. But sometimes we hold those grudges. We don't say hello to each other. Slam the door when we see the other person. Turn around when we see him coming from the house. And then we claim we are Christians. Jesus said, if you come to the orphan and there you have something to do with your neighbor, go first reconcile. Then you come and offer your sacrifice. Because otherwise your sacrifice has no meaning. You want to be united with God, who is love, when you are divided. What a contradictory term. Sometimes, you know, we think that we can play games with God. We can't. Either you are real or you're not. And you can fool me, you can fool everyone here, but you cannot fool him. You are going to be united with him in a very intangible way, and you are separated from your brother and sister. Do you recall the story of St. Paul when he was a persecutor of the church, when he was Saul, and he was going to Damascus, and all of a sudden he was thrown off his horse, and there on the floor he heard the voice, Saul, Saul, why are you persecuting me? And when he said, who are you that I am persecuting? I am Jesus whom you are persecuting. Now remember, Paul and Jesus never met in life, never. There is about 3 years after the resurrection when Paul, you know, was converted. So he does not even know the face of Jesus. But who persecuted the church, persecuted Jesus himself. Because the church and the bride and Jesus, are one and the same. And that's why he came with a beautiful writing to the Corinthians. We are the body of Christ. Christ is the head, we are the members of the body. And without the head, we cannot exist. It is the head that sends all the messages for our part of the body to act. And they act for one reason. If I want to go to the table, the head is telling me to stand up and begin moving my legs towards the table. I mean, if I don't correspond the head with the feet, I will fall. That's what happened to elderly people. They want to go, but the feet is not telling them to go, because they have no strength in them. And that's why they have those falls. And the same thing with the church. The church is working together. I call the church an orchestra. When you have an orchestra, you have all kinds of different instruments. You have the trumpet, you have the flute, you have every kind of instrument. And each part of the music is written purposely for that instrument so that it will be harmonized with the music. They put it in A, B, and C, whatever it is necessary to be done. So that when the orchestra play, all together become one symphony and one melody. The same thing with the church. We are one body. All of us, God has given us gifts. But all of us are working together for one cause, to build the body of Christ. And that's why we hear people say, or recognize there, the importance of unity with Christ and unity with one another. Jesus said, love one another as I have loved you. Do to others what I have done to you. And that is the manifestation of how much we love God. I mean, to love God is in the pew and thank God for all the blessings is very easy because you are ungrateful if you don't do that. But to love somebody who really, because of his action or his, you know, ways of dealing with you, have hurt you, is not very easy to forgive. My dear people, this is what mountains we need to take away before we approach to see this great mystery of salvation. When God loved us so much that he sent his son. I mean, it is mind-boggling how God, who needs no one, become nothing like me and you, so that you, who are nothing like me, make us something. In fact, they make us his children, brothers and sisters with Christ, as children of one Father. No other faith, no Hindu, no Buddhist ever have this action. In fact, humanity created God. Our God became reality by coming towards us and become one of us to lift us up from the misery of darkness, from the misery of sin, to give us and to lead, to make us come to that light, the light of his promise. What are the values that we need to fill? The value of pride. That pride, dear people, that is really the cause of many sins. Our Holy Father has issued forth the year of faith. And this year of faith, and we keep hearing people talking. The mystery of faith indicates to us that this year is a year where I am going to really evaluate what type of faith I have. And this faith is going to testify how much I really believe and have that relationship with the divine Son of God. And the Holy Father said, you know where it starts? It starts at the confessional. When I look at my weakness and acknowledge it, and I say that my weakness has caused me to sin. A few moments ago you say, I sin through my fault. Sometimes I don't know if you know what you are saying. If you have made a sin against the Ten Commandments, there is no forgiveness by saying the confession. You need to return to sacrament. We just have a day of obligation. Immaculate Conception, Friday night and Saturday morning. Some people take the law in their hands and they say, you know, I do what I want. So what kind of a Catholic? Are you obedient or not? And that is what Jesus teaches from the cross. He was obedient even to the word of the cross. Did he like it? No. Father, deliver me from it. But he obeyed. And that's what he wants from me and you, obedience. That's what we need to do. We need to go to confession. And after I confess my sins, I rise from that confession a new person. And I begin and again the journey with Jesus. And then when I am empty from all those things that really hinder me from knowing God and have a relation with him, I will conceive the Lord in my heart and give him birth in my soul. And when I am filled with him, then alone I can give him to others. My dear people, you cannot give from what you don't have. And that's why God wants us to give him totally and completely our heart, our mind, our body. Not half, love him with all your soul, with all your mind. So that after I love God, and I give God 100% of my own existence, then he will come to me. If I have some other love in my heart, God does not want to compromise. Either all or nothing. It's like you are inviting somebody to visit for the holidays. Many of you are content if you have your clothes on a chair and some books thrown here and some things here and there. You can live with it. But when you know that somebody is coming, you put everything in the closet, you clean, you run the sweeper, you dust everything, so that the person who is coming have a great welcome at your house. Jesus is coming, and he wants us to sweep our home, to clean our hearts, and to prepare a heart to welcome. My dear people, this is what we are going to do on the 19th of this month. I don't want to have no excuse from nobody. The sacrament of penance is a necessity to celebrate Christmas. How can you go from Christmas to Christmas, from Easter to Easter, without really reconciling with God and really cleaning yourself up from those things, even if they are not serious, just to refresh yourself and to gain sacrament, the grace of the sacrament? This is what the church is trying to say in the words of John the Baptist. Prepare the way of the Lord. Make smooth the way to come. Because if there is valley, if there is hell, we cannot have relationship with God. We cannot. And unfortunately, that's why in our world today we don't have relationship with one another. Because the reflection of the relation with God is the reflection that we have with one another. Many times, you know, you say, well, you know, after all, but I always believe, this is my belief, that all of us are animals with reason. And we have a habit of doing things. You can say whatever you want. Every one of us have those little nookies, little things that we have, that we do, little things that we do in our life that make us different from others. Sometimes, you know, if I want this in the middle, you want it on that side. Everyone is like it. That's what this goes, you know, but there is there are those things, there is no discussion about it, because you like it this way, I like it this way. But remember, dear people, that we are in a world today, and you don't know when the Lord will call us home. And when he calls us home, we need to be prepared. And that's why I am asking you to really think seriously with our Holy Father. Do I have a clean house? Is my things in order? If the Lord calls me home, I am ready to go. But there is something that I need to do before I go. So when I arrive in front of him, I will be pure and without blemish at the coming of my God. This is what Advent is all about. Unfortunately, sometimes the season of Advent is a time of running from one store to the other, spending hours on the computer buying things here and there, put your credit card in a disarray, because sometimes we buy friendship by gifts. Friendships are not gifts. Friendship is something that we need to have, because there is something that really unites us. It's not what you give, it's the heart that you give with. My dear people, as we have prayed in the opening prayer, don't let the material things hinder us from those ways to become holy, so that when he comes, we can be admitted to the company of saints. May the Lord help us. May the Lord strengthen us. May the Lord give us vision, so that we can know what the Lord wants from us, what we need to clean from our lives, to be ready at his coming. Amen.